One of the things that I, because you may have always done it this way, but just from where I sit, typically entrepreneurs and people that are starting up things, they're pretty just in general, rugged individualists, right? And they a lot of times see something wrong in the market or see something they can add, or they see the way that people are doing it, it's not good. And a lot of it is they want to kind of keep control of things. And I totally understand that. And it's not always a control issue versus a quality control type concept a lot of times. But I've noticed that you and some of the other guys you've worked with, and even talking about getting your students involved, you have, well, it seems like you have not had that approach. And you've had, you've had three, you're saying that these companies get sold and whatnot. I don't think it's typical for someone to have that kind of ratio where it's just more about perseverance. I mean, there's perseverance involved, of course, but you can't just keep going and then expect to, be able to exit. A lot of them kind of crash and burn. And what I've always been intrigued by you and some of the other guys you work with is these guys do these things as a team, and they started and they really seem to have a healthy chemistry. They kind of, you play this role and this person plays this role. And I don't see a lot of, there's not a lot of kind of fighting or bickering or stuff like that. And a lot of times with partners, I just see a ton of that going on. But it seems like you've been able to have healthy partnerships with other people to take these companies from, A to Z. I just don't see that as typical. So what do you think is that, first of all, am I right in saying that, or am I misunderstanding that? And then kind of secondly, what do you think the advantages of doing that? What do you think kind of is, or maybe the pros and cons of it? But then what's the kind of secret sauce and how you guys have been able to do that together, where it wasn't just one person kind of controlling everything?
Yeah, it's a great question. So I'll answer first by saying, like if you look at MedShape, it was some of my students. It's also Doug Picascio, who I think was a doctor. So he had the surgical expertise. I had the engineering expertise. My students kind of became some of the early, workhorses that were day-to-day pushing everything through. And we did things, one thing that I think is the secret sauce for us is we've always shared equity amongst a lot of the people that are in the businesses. So even as I've gotten into the later stages of businesses, so that was my first business, but even as I got into Vertera and Restore3D and other businesses, I've always taken the view that I want owners of the business to be working in the business. And I want to have a nice ownership stake that matters to me, but I don't want to have a controlling ownership stake. I don't want to, it doesn't have to be 50% of the business and I'm making all the shots. I want to have something that matters, but I want a lot of people to matter. And I think that's what binds us together in the end, is that we all care if the business is going to make it. It's not, and I think that in MedShape was a lot what helped us survive a long time was, we all had a meaningful ownership stake of the business over time. Now you obviously have investors, and so when the investors come in, they pick up ownership of the business.
Right.
I think that's been a difference. We've also, all of our businesses, and this goes against all venture capital approach, have all been common stock. They've 100% been investors, and employees are sitting in the exact same equity structure. And a lot of people think this is crazy, but this has provided returns for investors mainly because the employees, they don't want to fail, right? They're owners of that business and they want it to succeed. And they know our employees understand that common stock is more valuable if everyone has it and nobody has a preference. And they're not going to get, if an exit happens, they're not going to get crammed down and make nothing. And so some people will say, like, well, you're going to fail with common stock, but I think we've actually succeeded because of it, because we've actually had people that care. And if we also avoid people that don't care about ownership. So not every position, and not every person can take the same level of risk. So some people come in, they take huge risks and take huge ownership stakes. But if someone comes in and says, I'm not interested in any ownership, I just want cash, they're kind of a wrong fit for our team.
Yeah.
And they may need that cash, and that's fine. There's lots of places they can go, but we've generally tried to do that. And younger people sometimes need, when you hire someone straight out of school, they may have certain income requirements and stuff. I get all that, but in our mid-level to senior people, we're looking for people that want to take risk. And that I think has helped. And in the early days of MedShape and Vertera and the other ones that have exited, we've always had that structure. It's also helped us weather some bad times. So, you know, there was times when our CEO took no salary for 2 or 3 years in MedShape, right? And, you know, many of the other owners took pay cuts or took equity, and most businesses would have collapsed, right? Even though we had a great product and we're on a great run, that would have put them under. And ultimately that helped a lot as well.
Yeah. I mean, I've learned that sort of, you know, because Credo is not my first business, you know, and I've learned that. I remember even talking to my wife. I said, look, the minute that you are dependent on the income from the business, your chances of success go way down. It's almost like you can't mix business with personal. And I know that a lot of you guys have, you know, kind of day job kind of incomes. And it really is, because you're right. There's always going to be a point where there's a lot of pressure. And somebody's going to have to take a cut. Someone's going to have to put some money in or something like that. It's not always, it looks good in the end, right? But there's always a story. It's like being married. I mean, being married's great. You can be married for like 40 years or whatever and be like, yeah, but it wasn't always like Disneyland, right? I mean, there's times where we had to work through things, right? And it's good that we were married, because otherwise maybe we wouldn't have stayed together. But
yeah. No comment.
Smart man.
I see the recording thing on there. It's a note.
That's smart guy. So that's really interesting. And do you think, when you say that you guys cared about the business, do you think that it was because you cared about the business because you cared about each other and you were accountable to each other? So it was built in accountability, or was it you had a passion for what you guys were really doing to make the world a better place, or was it something else?
Yeah, I think it was actually three things. Two of them you mentioned, you know, it was, we did feel accountable to each other and we had a good team. And, you know, some people like Doug Kasha, I knew for a very long time, right? And Kurt Jacobus, who was in the business, and some of my students and other people have worked with me for decades, you know, and so we did have accountability. You know, we were also very passionate about putting new materials into biomedical devices. Like, we felt like that was our calling. Like, we could do this better than anyone in the world. And that was, I think, really, you know, kind of bound us together. I would be remiss to say it didn't matter, you know, it did matter that we were also going to have a potential payout, you know, so we were all, you know, running day jobs, but we, you know, the ownership and the ultimately the payout did matter too. You know, I don't know, I don't think that was 50% of it, but that played some, you know, some role of in those three things, right? Doing something you love with people you want to work with and making some good money doing it. I think that all matters.
Well, would it be fair to say you guys all shared sort of a delayed gratification maturity kind of thing?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's important. Okay. So what would you, now if somebody were to come to you and say, hey, you know, is it better to have, you know, all these partners and shareholders right out of the gate, or would it be better to do it later on? Or, I mean, what would you say based on what you learned? Because even though you've had some success in these areas, that doesn't mean that's necessarily the way you would do it if you did it over. So would you say, and if you're going to bring another equity, do it right away. Don't wait. Or would you say, just wait a little bit till you get it baked, it'll be better. What would you say to that?
We've brought equity on pretty early and partners on early. And so I've still liked that model. We still do that. We typically have more shareholders in our business than most other people, because I've found that when you have a smaller number, you never know what's going to happen. They may not be able to reinvest, or even if you tell them this is a long-term, we're going to have to invest multiple rounds, they may decide they don't want to. And it's not like a capital call where you signed up for a certain amount, you know, so when a new round comes, a shareholder can decide not to invest. So I've liked having shareholders pretty early, even in our new businesses, we've done that. So even if, I guess this is the ultimate way to say it, in Restore 3D, when it was founded, I had the capital to do the seed round myself, right? So I could have done the entire round, but instead I brought in, you know, some investors for the seed round to share, because it's such an early round. It's such a nice place to be. And so I bring those people in so that then they can share in the growth of the business. And when the rounds get bigger, it doesn't look as bad, right? Some people do the opposite, as you know, Dan. They bring people in very late, but then the valuations are higher. They're not vetted to the business. They're not, you know, in part of the story. And so I try to bring people in pretty early still, even if I had the capital for the whole round.
No, that's good. So, I mean, do you think that in general that it's great teams that make it happen. Is that fair to say?
Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. You know, that's, you absolutely have to have really good people on the investor side, on the, also on the, you know, the side of the operating people that are running the business day to day. And then we work with a lot of consultants and, you know, other types of people too. So you, yeah, no question. Yeah. Bad. I mean, the flip of that, of course, is we've made bad hires in the past. And, you know, what's really bad about bad hires is they stay around longer and they hire bad people. So you get like a worse effect than just that one person.